welcome everyone, and to thank the Gwen Borowski and the National Liberty Museum for hosting us, and Stanley Ginsburg and family for sponsoring this lecture series. This is the fourth and final program of our season this season. Of course, we'll be back in the fall. For those of you who are not familiar with FPRI, let me just say that the Foreign Policy Research Institute was founded in 1955 on the premise that a nation should think before it acts. It was good advice then, it remains good advice today. Our founder, Robert Strauss Pei, popularized geopolitics, which was a way of looking at international affairs through the lens of history, geography, and culture. Or as one of my colleagues likes to say, we study the realities of the mentalities of the localities. We have a vibrant program of lectures for the public in several different venues here in Philadelphia, the Main Line, Princeton, New York, and Washington, D.C. We also have an active program of publication, mostly electronic, but sometimes in print as well. And we have an active program of research on vital issues of the day. Today, we take pride in presenting programs that are right on target in terms of timeliness. Today, you might be wondering, could there be a less propitious time for a discussion of the two-state solution, since it doesn't seem at all in prospect. But nonetheless, a two-state solution, I think as it has been said, paraphrasing Winston Churchill, it is the worst solution to the problem between the Israelis and the Palestinians, but still better than all the alternatives. So it is always out there, and there has been movement, not necessarily at the political level, but just last week, a group of generals from Israel issued a report on ways to lay the groundwork for a two-state solution. So it is very much part of the landscape of the Arab-Israeli conflict, and we'll learn more about it today with a very important figure, Professor Shai Feldman, who is the director of the Crown Center of Middle East Studies at Brandeis University, where he's a professor of politics. He's also on the board of directors of the Belfer Center at Harvard for Science and International Affairs, and he served as director of the Jaffe Institute for Strategic Studies in Israel, which is now known as the Institute for National Strategic Studies, and which is one of the most important, if not the most important, think tank in Israel. He's the author of many books on Israeli nuclear deterrence, U.S.-Israel relations, Israel and Palestine. A couple of years ago, he and two of his colleagues presented a panel discussion at one of our history institutes for teachers on teaching Israel and Palestine. He brought with him his co-authors of a book called Arabs and Israelis, Conflict and Peacemaking in the Middle East. One colleague was an Egyptian, one colleague was a Palestinian, and it turned out to be a very fruitful discussion and something that the teachers could really begin to grapple with the different sides of that very complex issue. And that's what we're going to be doing today, so please welcome Shai Feldman.
Thank you, Alan, so much for this introduction. And I will take off from the book that Alan just mentioned, because I was asked to talk about the two-state solution, I thought that by the end of my talk, you have two alternatives. One is to go on Amazon and buy a copy of the book, and the other is to go to the nearest pharmacy and get Prozac. And I thought that the book is probably cheaper. So what I thought I would do today is on this issue of the two-state solution is to broaden a little bit the conversation by asking ourselves, and this is, you'll see in a second why this actually is based on the book, What are the prospects? Why are we in a situation where, and I'll get to some positive changes at the end, but generally speaking, why are we, broadly speaking, in such such despair? And the book that Alan mentioned is actually a book that my Palestinian and Egyptian colleagues and I wrote based on a class that we have been teaching at Brandeis. This fall was the 11th time that we've been teaching, co-teaching, team teaching this class. It's actually the only class that we know of in any American university or any other university, a class on the Arab-Israeli conflict that is team taught by an Israeli, a Palestinian, and an Egyptian. And there are essentially two purposes for the class, and the second will be the segue to my talk today. The first purpose is to essentially sensitize the students to the fact that almost every important turning point in the history of the Arab-Israeli conflict, Arabs and Israelis, but not just Arabs, Palestinians, Egyptians, everyone, every party, every protagonist in this conflict had a legitimate but very different narrative about what happened and especially why what happened happened. So what we try to do in this class is to sensitize the students to the fact that there are these competing narratives and that the competing narratives are equally legitimate. And when we translated the class into this book, it's actually the only book that where you could read side by side for almost every, we took about 22 turning points during the 116 or 118 years now of conflict, if you start counting from the first Zionist Congress. The side by side, you can read what was the Zionist, then Israeli narrative, what was the Palestinian narrative, what were the Arab narratives. But the second purpose of the class, which is the segue to my talk, is that we try to essentially provide the students with a toolbox to understand and explain those important turning points in the history of the conflict. And we try to essentially regularize the students to understand that if they want to understand and explain any important development in the history of the conflict, they have to answer for themselves four questions. One, what happened in the global arena that can explain this development in the conflict? Secondly, what happened in the regional arena that can explain what happened in the conflict? The third is, what happened in the domestic politics of the protagonists that can explain, that had impact, that can explain what happened in the conflict? And the fourth is, what was the role of individual leaders in explaining what happened? And what we also show the students is that at different turning points, the relative weight of these four explanations changes from time to time. Sometimes the conflict in the 1950s, much of the conflict was affected by the Cold War. So the global arena, the US-Soviet competition, affected much of the Arab-Israeli conflict. If you think about the breakthrough between Israel and Egypt, you take Sadat, the person, the individual, out of the equation, you can't explain what happened. So the relative weight of these four factors, and the way I try to do this with my students is to say, okay, now you're a junior staffer in the National Security Council, and the President of the United States sitting in the Oval Office just saw some breaking news on CNN, something happened in the Middle East, and he's giving the request to Susan Rice. He needs a memo in 10 minutes, page and a half, to explain what happened, okay? I say, okay, this page and a half of a memo has to have four paragraphs. What happened in the international arena that can explain what the president just saw? What happened in the region that can explain what the president just saw? What happened in the domestic politics of the protagonists that can explain what, and so on, and what's the role of individuals? Okay, now, translating this to today's topic, What I thought I would do is the following, is explain why we are in such despair by comparing the last few years to what I call the golden era of Arab-Israeli peacemaking. We forget that there was such a thing called the golden era in Arab-Israeli peacemaking. And the golden era was 4 years, 1991, 1992, 1993, 1994. In those four, in this very short period, you had, first of all, the Madrid conference, which was the first major state-to-state Arab-Israeli conference with a stated objective of reaching peace. Secondly, the Madrid conference resulted in a second development, which now hardly anybody remembers existed, which were a whole set of multilateral discussions, negotiations, between Israel, the Palestinians, and 13 Arab countries on four or five major issues, economic development, refugee resettlement, all the way to issues of regional security and arms control. And these working groups worked for 3 or 4 years to try to generate proposals, and many of the proposals were in fact generated. Then you had in 1993, the Oslo breakthrough between Israel and the PLO, something that people only a few years ago would have said would never, ever, ever happen. And that was in September 93. And finally, in November 1994, Prime Minister Rabin and King Hussein signed the Israeli-Jordanian peace treaty. So you had four major breakthroughs in Arab-Israeli peacemaking in this very short span of time. So what did it take? What did it take to make these breakthroughs? So what I will try to do is help you, which I don't do with my students, by trying to answer those four questions. What happened in these four issue areas that can explain what happened? So first of all, in the global, and my bottom line, as you will see, is the reason why we had these breakthroughs is that the stars were all arrayed in the correct direction. I have to be careful not to say the right direction, because then people will say, well, what do you mean? It's not the left direction. So the correct direction. First of all, on the international, you just had the end of the Cold War. The Soviet Union essentially was defeated and dismantled. So this was the unipolar moment. This was the point where the United States remained the only superpower. No one could oppose or compete with America's designs. So when President Bush, 41, and Jim Baker decided to convene the Madrid Peace Conference, the United States was the only superpower around. Secondly, at the regional level, the United States just led a coalition in 1991 in the Gulf War of moderate Arab countries, or which included moderate Arab countries like Egypt, Saudi Arabia, and even Syria. People forget, Syria was part of the coalition, that just defeated Saddam Hussein, and essentially tilted the regional power, the regional balance of power, in favor of the so-called more moderates and away from the radicals or the rejectionists, which included Iraq and Libya and Yemen. So that was one very important development at the regional level. The second thing is, the second thing that happened was that there was huge anger on the part of the leaders of most of the Gulf states, particularly at the PLO and Arafat, for having sided with Saddam during the Gulf War, which led them to stop the financial assistance to the PLO, which then placed the PLO in an impossible financial situation, and then forced Arafat to make the concessions that he made at Oslo to remain relevant. And the third development was that there was anger in Washington, particularly in the US Congress, at Jordan for King Hussein siding, or what was perceived as King Hussein siding with Saddam during the Gulf War. So Dennis Ross and Bill Clinton could persuade King Hussein that if he wanted to get Congress back on the positive side, which is to say to renew assistance to Jordan, he finally has to make a decision. And King Hussein, in fact, made the decision. So all the stars on the regional level were arrayed in the correct direction. Finally, on the domestic side, or just before finally, on the domestic side, the Israeli electorate just expressed its discontent with the no peace policy of the Likud at the time, led by Yitzhak Shamir. And Israel had financial requirements. It had to absorb 1 million refugees or Jews from the former Soviet Union. And by voting in the 1992 elections to bring Labor, led by Yitzhak Rabin, to power, essentially, this was a vote that would meet America's demands for the provisions of the $10 billion loan, government loan guarantees that Israel needed to absorb these immigrants. And on the Palestinian side, you had during the 3 or 4 years before the Gulf War, during the first Palestinian Intifada, the rise for the first time of a local Palestinian leadership in the West Bank that threatened to make the PLO leadership in exile irrelevant. So, which forced Arafat, if he wanted to become relevant again, to make the decisions that he made that allowed the Oslo Accords to be signed. Finally, on the leadership level, we had Israel led by Rabin. Rabin was often referred to as Mr. Security. And the important thing was that a majority of Israelis felt that they could trust Rabin with assessing the risks of alternative measures. And if he said, we can do this, then Israel can safely do this. And Palestinians were led by Arafat. I mean, you may disagree with the analogy, but I would say for the Palestinians, Arafat was their George Washington. Okay, he had the credibility of taking this scattered people and putting them together. So when he talked about the peace of the brave, people said, okay, you know, he can do this. He can lead us into this. And finally, on the United States side, the United States was led by Bush 41 and Jim Baker at first, who not only had the credibility of having just led the Gulf War coalition, but they also had the personal ambition to create a new world order, which they talked about, and even a new regional order in the Middle East in order to prevent another Gulf War from being necessary. So the bottom line is, again, you go through the global, the regional, domestic politics leaders, all the stars were arrayed in the correct direction, which is the reason why you had these four hugely important developments. So where are we now? We're now where none of the stars are faced in the right direction. At the international global level, as we know, the American moment, at least to the extent that there was an American moment in the early 90s, the American moment is over. Obama's efforts in the last 7 years were focused on avoiding big mistakes and major military commitments. The motto being, and now I'm giving you the vegetarian version, which is don't do stupid stuff. Obama does not have the ambition to restructure the Middle East, definitely not to the extent that Bush 41 and Jim Baker did. And one can't blame him. We have to remember, President Obama tried seriously twice to implement or to get the parties to agree to a framework for a two-state solution. In 2009, the effort was led by then former Senator George Mitchell. And then, of course, in 2013, when the president, slightly less enthusiastically, because of he was burnt already in 2009, at least gave the green light to John Kerry to try his best. And we know where these two efforts have ended. My own view, in early June, with this administration having the months that it has left, the chances that he was going to give a green light to anyone to try to implement a resolution of this conflict is as close to zero as you can imagine. So, what you can expect from any of those who are now contending to replace Mr. Obama in the White House, I leave it completely up to you. So That's at the global level. At the regional level, we basically have a post-Arab Spring. As you know, this is entirely a misnomer because there is no spring in the Middle East. In the Middle East, you move immediately from the winter to the summer. There is basically anarchy and chaos. We've got four Middle East countries that when I entered this profession 35 years ago, you can accuse me of having completely screwed up the Middle East. The reality is that four countries, Syria, Iraq, Yemen, Libya, who are in some one way or another pillars of the region, are no longer there. And during the 5 years, the 5 years of the Syrian civil war has taken a larger toll than the entire 118 years of the Arab-Israeli conflict. Just think about that. And the result is that even those that are not part of this complete chaos, even those countries that are there, like Egypt and Jordan, are completely self-absorbed and engulfed by their domestic issues. So the bottom line is that right now, solving the Arab-Israeli conflict is not a priority for anyone in the region. Everybody has their number one and number two problem, and whether this is number 18 or number 9 or number 7, it's definitely not number one. Now, the domestic front. On the domestic front, we've got two problems. On the Israeli side, and this ties very closely to the report that Alan mentioned regarding Israeli security. I will give you my CNN version of Israeli politics. I call it the 25-50-25 version of Israeli politics, which is to say that essentially the Israeli domestic scene comprises of 25, I would say, right-wing ideologues, 25%. About 25% of relatively left-wing ideologues, which is people who will support a peace process, a peace plan, will not deal with the details, but they will support it. We have 50% in between. And the question is, what is the DNA of those 50%? Before I get to the DNA, I have to say, so that there'll be no misunderstandings, in the last 10 years, the Israeli politics have been dominated by the right. And you can ask yourself, why is it? If the formula is 25-50-25, why is it? Why is it dominated by the right? It is because whenever you read a public opinion poll, remember that you're only told about the distribution of opinion. You're seldom told about the relative intensity with which opinions are being held. And the right wing in Israel today is committed and organized and mobilized. And the center and the center left is not. And the question is, again, why is it not? And there are essentially two answers to that. First of all, because it lost faith. The left has lost faith. Rightly or wrongly, the Israeli left and center has become convinced that Israel does not have a Palestinian partner, that from Camp David 2000 to Arafat's failure to embrace the Clinton parameters in 2000 to Abbas's failure to accept or embrace the proposals that then Prime Minister Olmert presented him with. The Palestinians, that is the narrative of the Israeli center, is that the Palestinians rejected every reasonable offer. And so first of all, there is, as I said, there is despair, there is loss of faith because of this narrative that the Palestinians are not a partner. And the second thing, and the second reason why they're at home is because, and that addresses directly, and this is why this report is important, the second reason is because the center is terrified, is paralyzed by fear. Rightly or wrongly, the Israeli center has become convinced that Israel Israel's withdrawal from Lebanon in 2000 was reciprocated by Katyusha rocket attacks from Lebanon, which resulted in the 2006 war, that Israel's withdrawal from Gaza in the summer of 2005 by now resulted in three wars between Israel and Hamas. And the question that the Israeli center is asking itself is, what if Israel did the same from the West Bank? What if Israel withdrew from the West Bank to enable a two-state solution, just as it withdrew from Lebanon or from Gaza? What would happen if it withdrew from the West Bank that's adjacent to where 80% of Israel's GDP is produced, which is to say the center core of Israel? And now on top of this, you've got the Arab Spring, right? And the fact that you have in a neighboring country like Syria the kind of carnage that I mentioned earlier that you see. And by the way, the perception of this carnage is very different if you're in Israel than if you're here. Because if you're here, in the last 6 months, the four evening hours of CNN is totally devoted to the last statement that Donald Trump has made about anything, right? In Israel, if you watch the news on the evening, you're more likely than not to see YouTube footage from the latest carnage, whether it's Aleppo or Homs or Deir al-Zour and so on and so forth. So the chaos around Israel and the killing around Israel is in everybody's home every evening. So the result is that it's very easy to persuade the Israeli center today to just hunker down, not to take any risks, because any mistake maybe fatal. And in the Palestinian domestic scene is similarly paralyzed for other reasons. Palestinians have also lost faith in the process. They've seen their hopes shattered time after time. And they have their own analysis, and believe me, it does not correspond to the Israeli analysis as to who is responsible for these failures. And then you've got this total split between Hamas and Fatah, between the Palestinian Authority in Ramallah and Hamas in Gaza, and a total loss of legitimacy by the Palestinian Authority. President Abbas's term ended somewhere like 6 or 7 years ago, and it's been extended artificially. So the Palestinian domestic scene is also completely paralyzed. Now, what happens when you talked about the leadership? Well, you can summarize the whole discussion by saying, well, Netanyahu is not Rabin. But I don't want to say this in a facetious way. The reality is, my problem as a strategic planner and analyst of Netanyahu is more the fact that he seems to be consumed by risks, consumed by threats, and doesn't see also opportunities. And I'll get to that in a second. He frightens the already frightened center, and especially the Israeli center. He is, I have to say, a master of manipulating fears. So if the public doesn't remember why they should fear making serious concessions, you can always count on Netanyahu to remind them why they have to be concerned about these. And the reality is that Abbas is not Arafat. As I said, Arafat for the Palestinians was their George Washington. He doesn't have Arafat's legitimacy, let alone the courage to make the difficult decisions. And so he's not capable. He just doesn't have it. He doesn't have the DNA to do what Arafat used to call the peace of the brave. So the bottom line is, as you saw, all stars in the last few years, for all these reasons, were arrayed in the wrong direction. This to me, before I get to my last point, my next to the last point is, from an Israeli standpoint, in my view, this is a disaster. This is a disaster for a number of reasons. First of all, it's a disaster because of the effect of the lack of a two-state solution. And this goes back again to another point that Alan made, that everything is relative. But without a two-state solution, Israel cannot be and cannot remain a Jewish and democratic state. There's just no way you can circle this square. If Israel continues to retain the millions of Palestinians that it controls, continues to control against their will, something has to give. You give them political rights and remain a democracy, Israel is no longer a Jewish state. Okay? Arabs will have 50% members of the Knesset. You deny them, you're no longer a democracy. by some miracle, right, next year will be 50 years since the territories Israel won the 67 war, somehow Israel is still seen as a Jewish and democratic state. I don't think this can remain forever. The second point is that the Palestinians will shift. They are already beginning to shift their discourse to the issue of equal rights within Israel at large. What does that mean? Essentially, they're trying to shift the conversation to what I call a South Africa conversation, to undermine Israel's legitimacy. And here we should remind, as an Israeli, I can say, we Israelis, we have to remind ourselves that Israel's legitimacy is based on one UN resolution. It's called UN Resolution 181, accepted historically on November 29, 1947. It called for the creation of two states, a Jewish state and an Arab state. So the loss of hope in the ability to implement UN Resolution 181 will increasingly raise questions about Israel's legitimacy itself, providing headwind tailwind is probably the better analogy, to organizations and movements like the boycott and diversity movement that you see already in American campuses. I also think, and that leads to my third consequence, this will have a negative effect on U.S.-Israeli relations. To the extent, and I emphasize, to the extent that Israel will be seen as responsible for the failure to implement a two-state solution, and Israel is not the only party responsible, Israel will increasingly become a polarizing partisan issue. It is already, as you know, become a partisan issue because of the Iran issue. We can get into that a little later. But young American liberals will increasingly question the wisdom of Israeli policy, while Republicans, especially evangelical Christians, will remain highly supportive of Israel. This is a trend we've seen in the last 10 years, and we see it now increasingly. So what will happen is that Israel, and my fear is that Israel will gradually lose the support of important segments of the American Jewish community, especially the young Jews who remain predominantly Democratic and predominantly liberal. And my fourth point is the stalemate in the ability to implement a two-state solution will breed further stalemate. And the reason is that the Palestinians are listening to this debate, and we have no way of avoiding this. This is being taped. My talk is being taped. And Palestinian and all these discussions in Israel are being taped and being broadcast. And the Palestinians learn that the failure to implement a two-state solution is a disaster for Israel. So their question is, more and more, why should we Palestinians make the concessions needed to implement a two-state solution if the discourse is actually shifting in our direction? If we can be sure that in 10 or 15 years we can structure a South Africa kind of conversation, maybe we will be able to undermine Israel's legitimacy without actually making the concessions that we are being asked to make. So the stalemate breeds further stalemate. Okay, now, before you either run to the next bookstore to get a copy of our book or to the nearest pharmacy to get some Prozac, let me just add by saying, yes, there is an array of hope in the last couple of years, in particular in the last couple of months, and particularly in the last couple of weeks. And the reason is, it's the other side of the coin of what happened in one of the four levels that we discussed earlier, which is at the regional level. And I'll make 3 points about this. First, it's the other side of the first of the fact that we are talking about a region that has been totally transformed. Now, the way it's transformed negatively, I've already talked about. But the positive side, especially when it relates to the implications of this for a two-state solution, is that the new environment has created three very important common denominators between Israel and key Sunni Arab countries, particularly Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Jordan. The first is the common threat of Islamic extremism and violence and terrorism. All of us, which is to say Egyptians, Jordanians, Saudis, Israelis, are focused now on this threat. And it's not just ISIS. ISIS is just one of the potential sources of this threat. Secondly, all four, Israel, Saudi Arabia, Jordan, and Egypt, are in a geopolitical, geostrategic competition with Iran. Okay, everywhere. Whether it's in Syria, whether it's in Iraq, whether it's Yemen. Now, of course, the Israelis are focused more. Israelis are more focused on their backyard, which is to say Syria. And Iran's involvement in Syria and Lebanon. Okay? But others are focused on what is their backyard. If it's the Egyptians, they're focused on Iran's influence on Hamas and so on. So that's number two. And the third is the feeling, rightly or wrongly, and that goes back to, again, the point that I made earlier, but the feeling, rightly or wrongly, by the Israelis, the Egyptians, the Saudis, and the Jordanians, that the United States is no longer in the business of trying to shape developments in the Middle East. Now, I pointed to this fact earlier as a negative, but the reality is that this also is potentially a positive, because it means that the parties themselves have to realize now that there is no one out there right now, and again, you'll tell me what happens after January 20, but right now their feeling is no one from the global level is providing adult supervision. Now, that means the children have to take care of themselves. Okay, they can't rely on Washington to come and take all their chestnuts out of the fire. So the most important development here is that the Egyptians, the Jordanians, and especially the Saudis are saying to themselves, we have to take some responsibility. So that's number one. Number two is there seems to be, and that's connected to that, there seems to be a situation where the key Arab countries, such as Saudi Arabia and Egypt, are now prepared, again, because they can't rely on Washington to do what Washington always did. They are now prepared to facilitate a resolution of the conflict that doesn't undermine Israel's interests. And the number of events, all of them informal until now, that senior Saudis have been taking part in with senior Israelis, senior former heads of the Saudi security and intelligence services, with senior former heads of the Israeli intelligence services, is unprecedented. If you look at the last 2 years, what's happened in the last 2 years, there is no precedence for that. Now, here's my third point, just in case you thought I would really end with a happy end. The third point is, yes, there is this new reality. This new regional reality is opening up new opportunities. It's created almost a club. A club that some people refer to as the Concert of Arabia plus Israel, which again refers to the willingness of the Saudis, the Egyptians, and the Jordanians to cooperate and trying to maybe even move a two-state solution forward. The problem is, until now, and this is where the last 2 weeks are worth watching, is that joining the new club involved what I call membership fee. And the membership fee that the Saudis have reiterated time and time again in every informal and formal conversation was that Israel has to accept the 2002 Arab Peace Initiative, which the Saudis offered in 2002. And Israel was reluctant to accept as the basis for Israeli-Arab negotiations. Will Israel make the leap? In the last 2 weeks, which is the reason why this is an interesting time to watch, there have been more statements by Prime Minister Netanyahu and his new defense minister that seem to be moving in that direction. They're not quite there yet, but they are definitely are moving in the right direction. Let's hope they don't change course. This, of course, leaves still a number of very important questions. What do these recent changes in Israeli domestic politics, the reshuffling of the cabinet, what does that mean for the prospects of a two-state solution? What would a post-Abu Mazen Mahmoud Abbas leadership on the Palestinian side mean for the future ability to influence, to implement or negotiate and implement a two-state solution. And now for the third time, I'll say my third question, which I will invite you to answer, is what would U.S. policy in the Middle East be like after January 20? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
I guess the Middle East is the only place where all these negatives can add up to a positive. But we'll see. We have time for some questions. Rachel will come around with a microphone. Please wait till she comes to you and speak directly into the microphone. So if you could just raise your hands if you have a question, she'll come at you. Rachel, we have Steve Plotkin.
Thank you, sir. Just wondering how you accommodate that array of missiles surrounding Israel.
You you combine essentially a policy that includes a very, very strong element of defense. And as you know, thanks to consistent support of the U.S. Congress that made financially this possible, Israel has developed a whole array of capabilities to deal with missiles, beginning with rockets, beginning actually with very, very short range and low yield rockets like the Qassam rockets, all the way to long range missiles like the Jihad, like the Shihab 3 that the Iranians are developing. And I can also tell you that other countries in the world are taking very strong interest in this technology that Israel developed. It doesn't take, I think, a lot of imagination to realize that if you were a Taiwanese today, you would take a lot of interest in the kind of capabilities that Israel has developed. And secondly, there is deterrence. Now, of course, we know that in the conventional realm, deterrence is much more complicated than in the nuclear realm. But the reality is also that people jump too quickly to decide that, you know, deterrence is eroding when it actually hasn't. So if you look at the Israeli discourse, the Israeli internal discourse immediately after the 2006 war, because Israelis were rightly self-critical and unhappy with the performance of their defense community, military especially, in the 2006 Second Lebanon War, there was a discourse for the first 3 months about how Israeli deterrence has deteriorated. But the reality is that it's now 10 years later. 10 years, and Hezbollah has not really presented a major challenge to Israel in 10 years. And of course, deterrence also requires very careful signaling. So in this very complicated arena, Israel has managed to both continue to pursue defense against this wide array of capabilities that Hezbollah has, also, by the way, from time to time to interdict shipments. Not too often, but when good intelligence was available, Israel could do that. But the most important other element was the signaling to Hezbollah that Israel, there is some red lines, and one of the most important red lines is that Israel will not accept the extension of the Lebanese front to the Golan Heights. And so whereas Israel was actually tolerant since the upheavals in Syria began, was quite tolerant of some very nasty groups situating themselves on the other side of the border in Syria, Israel made a very clear distinction between that and Hezbollah. And when Hezbollah sent a scouting mission in preparation for its effort to try to extend the fronts to the Golan, basically Israel liquidated that group. And the most important was the signal, this is not something Israel will accept. even though, again, life is full of paradoxes. I mean, the reality is that most Syrian wounded that Israel is actually treating in Israeli hospitals, they actually come to Israel through an area of the Golan that's commanded by the Al-Nusra Front, which is affiliated by Al-Qaeda. But the Middle East is full of...
Shai, can you tell us the impact of 10 years of disagreement and political turmoil between the Palestinian factions on the prospects of peace? And does it matter that these constituencies have lived so separately in Gaza and in the West Bank for so long and that there has been this political gap?
Well, it matters because the real question is then... any deal that you make with Mahmoud Abbas or whoever comes after him, the question is, where will this deal be implemented, by who? And this is why Palestinian domestic politics has been as toxic as Israeli domestic politics for the prospects of a two-state solution. Right now, with all the discussions, and they come and go about so-called reconciliation, none of these have really worked out for one simple reason, which is that Hamas, with all this, all these efforts at reconciliation are not fake. They are real because they respond to a real public demand, and the Palestinian public demands unity, okay? But the problem is that these two regimes in Gaza and in Ramallah are, so their response to this public demand is to make believe as though they are in serious efforts to reconcile. But no one wants to give up his turf, okay? Hamas has complete control over Gaza. Now you can say, I mean, basically, what are you in complete control of? A kind of an asylum? You know, I mean, this is the biggest, it is true. You don't have to be pro-Palestinian to know that Gaza is one of the largest prisons in the world, because you've got 1.1 million people there that have no ability to exit or enter anywhere. I mean, and the Egyptian constraints on entry and exit are at least as tight as the Israeli constraint. So what message does this, you know, allow Hamas to present to the public is a big question. But the PLO itself, the PA itself, is not willing to seriously share power with Hamas, and until Hamas changes its position on Israel, then there are other constraints. And Israel is not going to allow the PA to include Hamas. Israel has resisted all reconciliation governments. The European Union, the quartet, has its own preconditions for recognizing this kind of reconciliation. So no one among them is willing to give up turf. That doesn't mean that will be forever the story. It's possible. Here's the untold part of this, which is on the leadership level, the only person that seems to have the legitimacy that Arafat had to make the kind of quote-unquote peace of the brave is Marwan Barghouti, who is in Israeli jail, okay? Now, there's another interesting aspect about Hamas and the DNA of Hamas. Hamas essentially comprises of essentially three main, four main factions, right? First, you've got the moderate leadership, the so-called moderate leadership in Gaza, which is headed by Ismail Haniyeh. You have the militant arm of Hamas in Gaza, people of the military arm and Sheikh Zahar and so on and so forth. And then you have the Hamas abroad, Hamas in the diaspora. The most moderate wing of Hamas are the Hamas prisoners in Israeli jails. Now, then that means that Marwan Barghouti, who's been talking to these people for the last 10 years, it's already resulted in something very interesting for those who are as masochistic as I am to follow these details, right? something called the prisoner's document. People forget that such a thing existed. It was an effort by the Fatah and Hamas prisoners in Israeli jails to essentially negotiate the framework for a deal with Israel. This is where potentially this can come from, because there is criticism by both the Fatah prisoners and the Hamas prisoners at their respective national leadership that they're putting their own personal interests ahead of the national interest. So if they will seriously roll up their sleeves, then again, maybe there's a ray of hope here.
How do you factor into your equation the recent warming, seemingly warming of relationships between Russia and Israel, one, and two, the movement by France into the picture, encouraging its proposal?
Let me start with the end. I think that the French proposal is another sign of frustration. There's a difference between, and it's an understandable sign of frustration. The frustration and the attempt here is to essentially to avert a larger degree of frustration among Palestinians. So when people saw, when the French began to initiate this, people saw the upsurge of violence about 6-8 months ago. And particularly because this violence was very, very different from the Second Intifada, right? In its all its characters, it's not suicide bombing, it's individuals knifing. The most important thing is it's not organizationally driven. It wasn't driven by the militants of Fatah, it wasn't militant driven by Hamas, it's people finding their own way to express their frustration, and mostly it's kids 20, 12 years old, 14 years old, 16 years old, and so on. That led to a general feeling that there is despair, and that this despair has to be somehow addressed. Now, do I think that the Europeans, who can't actually agree on almost anything, will actually be able to become a unitary actor? And put this, there's another parenthesis I should open. It's also despair with respect to the U.S. So if you today had an active U.S. involvement, as you had in 2009 and during the Kerry mission, then of course there would be no role for the Europeans. The Europeans are walking in there because there is a vacuum. The French are walking in there because there is a vacuum. But is this a real, you know, can this actually result in something significant? Can this be anything other than the next source for Palestinian frustration that nothing's moving? It's hard for me to see. With Russia, it's a very complicated story. I think that, first of all, maybe there is also a personal chemistry involved, something that at that level certainly did not exist in the last 7 years between President Obama and Prime Minister Netanyahu. There may be a chemistry element involved here. But I think that this tightening, or let's say more intense relationship, closer cooperation, closer conversation, is necessitated by a reality. And the reality is a reality that both Russia and Israel understand, both Putin and Netanyahu understand, and even most important, the two countries' defense communities understand. And that is that with this rise of increase in this Russian military presence, especially in the air, it's on the ground in Latakia and Tartus, but it's the most important is it's on the air. This whole area that we're talking about, which is the area between Damascus and the sea, which is where, you've got the two bases that were, by the way, bases, they were Russian bases when I was a soldier, and that was many, many years ago. Latakia and Tartus were the the base of Russia, the Soviet Union at the time, in Syria. And they've basically, and they've never given up those that military presence in those two bases. But there's been a major upsurge there. But this area is a very, very, very small, narrow area, okay? And this area is of interest to the Russians, who have a project, which is to prevent Assad from falling. And it is of interest to Israel, because this is exactly the area through which much of the nasty stuff that moves from Iran to Damascus and then to Hezbollah moves. So Israel, the Israeli Air Force and the Israeli and the Russian Air Force are moving, are operating in a very, very tight area, okay? Which if you want to avoid the kind of catastrophes that already happened between the Turks and the Russians, requires very, very tight coordination. And the reality is that, again, among all the unprecedented things, you had about 8 months ago, the deputy chief of staff of the Russian Armed Forces visiting the IDF headquarters in Tel Aviv. And there is now a system in place to prevent, and there was already one incident when a Russian fighter jet entered the Israeli airspace, and luckily, because of the general policy of that Israel has, Israel did not react the way the Turks reacted, did not intercept the airplane, but again, the understanding is these are, you know, Israel and Russia are now operating in this very, very narrow space, and if they don't closely cooperate and coordinate, some bad things can happen.
Bob Grant?
If your hypothesis that the four variables may wind up somehow or other beginning to align, where does the West Bank and the settlers in the West Bank play into any possible two-state solution?
So here, this goes back to what I said earlier about my analysis of the DNA. The issue is this. The 25% of the Israeli public, they're who are ideologically against making the kind of concessions that are required for a two-state solution. Now, of course, that 25% is not all zealots, but it includes some people who are really willing to give up their lives for their ideological predispositions. The reason why I just go back to the point I made, the reason why they set the agenda is not because they are more than 25%. It's because that 50% in between are dormant for all the reasons I mentioned. So the question is it possible? And this is a big challenge. Is it possible to galvanize those 50% and essentially to wake them up? But it requires two things. It requires waking them up, and it requires addressing their real fears. And you have to, everybody who seeks a two-state solution has to understand that these people have legitimate fears. If you live in Tel Aviv, okay, adjacent to the West Bank, and you make a very, as I said, you draw a very simple analogy to the ability of Hamas to paralyze the South when it wanted to three times, and the ability of Hezbollah to paralyze the North in 2006. You say to yourself, well, wait a minute, this is where 65% of the population is, this is where 80% of the GDP. Remember one very small yield rocket from Gaza paralyzed Ben Gurion International Airport for 48 hours. Why? It's not that planes can't land or take off because some rocket landed in the vicinity of the airport. It's for a very simple reason. The minute something like that happens, all the airlines get a call from Lloyd's of London saying, "Forget about so they start landing in Cyprus." Then they land in Tel Aviv, take passengers, immediately leave. No, they don't. Anyway, complicated story. But the reality is, so the Israelis have already witnessed a small example of the ability with relatively simple weapons to paralyze the country. Which is why it is so important this recent development of people who have an impeccable record in Israel's defense and intelligence community who have retired, who are now coming around to essentially put together a defense plan, a security plan, that can explain to Israelis, if we put this plan in place, we can, the risks that we will take will be a calculated risks, and here's the calculation. Here's the array of measures that Israel can take with the help of others to offset these risks. And the other thing that's important is that some of the leaders in the region understand this. So Sisi is not just talking about, oh, now you know, I'm willing to now host a summit between Arafat, between Abbas and Netanyahu. He knows that this will lead nowhere, and this doesn't change the equation. But Egypt basically says, now again, we have to take everything with a grain of salt given all the problems that Egypt itself is facing, okay? But Egypt basically is, Sisi is now saying, you know, if this will require the deployment of Egyptian forces, for example, in the West Bank, we're willing to do it. Now, again, I don't think that any Israeli general is going to, you know, sign off on this idea. But it also means that, like Sadat at the time, because what was the revolution of Sadat? Everybody points to the fact that he came to Jerusalem. Yes, he came to Jerusalem, and it was a huge breakthrough. But the content of his speech in Jerusalem was the key here, because in Arab narratives, again, the book is all about that, in Arab narratives, the Israeli security concerns for in the Arab narratives were always a pretext. This was a pretext, in their view, that Israel used in order to not to make concessions that are required. The revolution in Sadat was that he came to the Knesset, spoke above the heads of 120 members of the Knesset to the Israeli public. And the most important element of that speech was, I understand that you have legitimate security concerns. Now let's break our heads together. How do we address your security concerns in a way that's not at the expense of our territory? Okay? And now Sisi is basically, now, decades later, Sisi is going back to Sadat, saying to the Israelis, I read you, I understand you, you've got security concerns, let's think about how we address them.
I think we'll have to bring this to a close. Thank you very much. I just want to thank Shai Feldman for a wonderfully rich, multi-layered, judicious balance sheet of the problems and potentialities of a two-state solution. So I thank Shai. Join me once again in thanking him for a great talk. Thank you. Before you go, I probably should mention that in a couple of weeks we'll be announcing our new slate of Fox Fellows in our Middle East program, and one of them happens to be Benedet Berti, who is based at the Institute for National Strategic Studies, which is the successor organization to the Jaffe Institute that Shai had directed. And I think some years ago we had one of your predecessors, Asha Susser, here to talk about the two-state solution.
Asha was at the Down Center, but we're
okay. anyway, this week we're hosting another talk on Thursday at our office at 11:30 on Sino-Japanese relations, a topic much removed from today's, with our scholar June Teufel-Dreyer. And tomorrow we'll be in Washington, D.C. for a half-day conference on the future of Taiwan. And then next week, the same topic will be covered at our Geopolitics with Grant Airey at BNY Mellon. So even though the season is winding up, we still have an active 2 weeks ahead of us, and then we'll take a little rest. So thank you for joining us tonight, and see you soon.